today, with the great support of Monexo and Metta, we are privileged to have a chance to hear from Ron Zuber at Prosper, and I will now turn it over to Mukesh.
Thank you, Tara. Welcome, everybody. I think we have a lot of Hong Kong events, but it's a privilege to have Ron Zuber, president of Prosper, with us today. Lots been spoken about Ron Zuber on business, but just to introduce some of the accomplishments. Prosper is a leading peer-to-peer lending company in US. They did about $1 billion in the first 6 years, but Ron came and did a magic. Did the next $1 billion in 6 months, and now they do $1 billion a quarter. It's a pretty large organization, changing the way lending and investing is happening there. And he travels quite a bit. He's an industry figure creating that market, a big fan of marketplaces, has made 15 investments himself. So let's give a round of applause and welcome Ron Zuber. First time in Hong Kong?
This is my second time here. Had a great time. It's just rained just a little bit in the last 2 days. Been very fun.
Okay. All conference rooms, or did you get to see Hong Kong a little bit?
Just a little bit. Yeah.
And what do you like about Hong Kong? Not Hong Kong here.
It's interesting. You can feel the energy here. Like, you go to different cities. So this year, I've been to Israel and Turkey and India, Cambodia and Vietnam, and now here. In some cities, you can really feel the vibe, feel the what's happening without hearing anything. And you can definitely feel what's happening here in Hong Kong just by walking around and watching the people and listening to the stories. And I'm really happy to share my observations and my experiences as a personal investor, as a very big fan of Fintech and what we're doing in this new online marketplace for credit today.
We're going to take a little off track, beaten path, and keep Ron away from asking business questions. Look a little deeper into who's Ron, frankly. So Ron, how do you prepare for the day ahead? What do you do the first thing when you wake up? It's coffee, gym, what's it?
So for me, I'm a very big fan of a philosopher in America who just passed away this last year. And his name is Wayne Dyer, D-Y-E-R. He's written lots of books and done lots of TV shows about intention and the power of each of our intentions. And so what I do every single morning before I get up, literally before I get out of bed, is try to understand what is it that I want to do today as a professional, as a son, as a husband, as a father, as a friend, at Prosper and in my personal business life. And once I have my intention set, I then get out of bed and start my day. And I think that's one of the very quick things I want to make sure everybody does, because you can get to a point in your life, whether you're 40 or 50 or 70 like I am, where your whole life passed you by and you didn't do what you intended to do. And I think life tries to pull us away from our intention all day long. So if you can understand what your intention is as a professional, as a spouse, as a child, as a friend, and do it, then at the end of the day, go back and review what you thought you wanted to do that day and see where you veered off and who made you veer and how do you do the next day to live more true to your intention.
More like a to-do list?
So it's more than a to-do list. Yeah, it's deeper than that. It's very, very important. It's literally an every single day requirement for me.
How were you in your college days? Did you ever imagine a life like this, or you wanted to be a baseball player or something else?
So at 17, I left home, left high school, and went to college to become a doctor, because that's what I was supposed to do. That's what people told me my life's intention was. My grandfather was a doctor. I always did the things people said. So I went to undergraduate medical school and flunked out, literally. Probably partied a little too much, but didn't really do well at the pre-med biochem stuff. And so I took my 22-year-old car, packed it up, and changed colleges in the beginning of my second year and told my family that I wasn't going to be a doctor. and went to another college undeclared. Showed up without an apartment, and in the grocery store parking lot found a lady who was renting a room in her place. And I literally called my parents and said, I need some money. And so my point is, you have to figure out as soon as you can, even though it might disappoint others who have expectations for you or your life, what is it that you really want to do? And so I really went through undergraduate college, and three friends and I started a bank in college. We put the really pretty people up front as the tellers. We stole American Express. We have credit checks here. And we started getting people to give us money, and we would lend out money. And that's where I first got addicted to this. Wait a second. You can take money from somebody and lend it to somebody else in that, I'll call it, offline. And so that's really what we're doing online, is helping people borrow and lend to each other 20 years.
This wasn't up in CNBC today. No, we didn't get there. Moving a little deeper, to your father, your husband, the president of Prosper, you're an industry leader. How do you manage all that? And we've been hearing about your three circle philosophy. So tell us all about that.
Yeah, so one of the things that I think has helped me is that I'm really trying to focus on what's important and who's important, and really removing those people and things that don't really matter. And if you go to Twitter, if anybody uses Twitter here, you'll see I retweeted something on the walls of LinkedIn in San Francisco. And it's focused on what really matters. And we'll get to the Prosper story from January of 13. What did we do when we got to Prosper, when they were getting $9 million a month, when they had 77 employees, and the valuation was $40 million. How did we focus Prosper to get it to north of $400 million a month and close to a $2 billion valuation 3.5 years later? So to me, I think focus is really critical. And that means removing people and things from your life that don't fit and don't really matter as well.
Now, that story of 6 years, 1 billion, and 6 months, another billion. I've been at the bank, and I could never imagine any bank scale that fast to do that kind of volume, for capital, for people, for the systems. I couldn't ever imagine that. So don't try getting Facebook friends with Ron if you're not in the circle. He doesn't want you.
I'm not on Facebook.
Yeah.
So in 2011, I had a friend of mine who went to work at LendIt, and he's the one who turned me on to this whole thing. It was early, like 2011. And so I put a little money on Lending Club and started lending money to see how this worked. And I tried to research, what is this thing? And every time I researched peer-to-peer online lending, Lending Club, one thing kept coming up. And it was Peter Renton. I'm like, who is this guy, Peter Renton?
Peter.
Does everybody know Peter Renton in the front row here? Can they get to lendacademy.com and read all the good stuff that you and Ryan and everybody writes? This is a great, I think, repository of information about this industry and the story. There are now 70 podcasts of people who've come to tell their story and answer questions about their own journey. I highly recommend the Lend Academy site and the podcasts that are very educational also.
Ron, we're going to pick up a little bit on the deeper side of Ron, and we'll get to some of the uncomfortable situations you've been. So talk through us, one such uncomfortable situation, how did you go through it, how is your belly feeling, and how did you come out of it?
I'll try to do this and not cry. So when I was 18, my parents went bankrupt, and we had no money. I literally had holes in the bottoms of my shoes, and I had tape on the inside and tape on the outside. And it was raining, and my socks were wet in high school. Literally no money. So I called my grandparents and I said, I don't need any money. I just want you to co-sign for a credit card so I can get a credit card to build credit and get some money and go on airplanes. And they said no. And so I've never forgotten that moment of trying to understand your net, your ability to borrow money, your ability to access credit. And for me, that's been this fire in the belly. And I'm hoping everybody can try to remember that moment in your life that you said, I'm going to be different. This is never going to happen. control of the situation, whether it's your health or your money or something else. But for me, I thank my parents and my grandparents for not giving me the money, for not co-signing that contract. Because that's one of the things that really, really drove me. I will never forget having wet socks and tape on my shoes in high school.
So, college dropout, if the students note that, tape on the shoes, and today, one of the successful entrepreneurs running one of the biggest peer-to-peer lending companies globally. Take a little knock down to get you know a little better. What's your favorite song on iPod which has been played the maximum number of times?
That's not fair.
It gives out the age. You've already given that out.
So I was running yesterday morning in the gym to a medley of the Cars and Bruce Springsteen, which I think 80% of the people here probably haven't heard one of those. So the Cars, which is a band from the 80s, and Bruce Springsteen was on my running list yesterday morning in the gym.
And a movie that you've watched more than 10 times.
So I'm a huge fan of the Rocky series. I think sports is life, and I think we can learn lots of lessons from athletes and people who've overcome personal adversity and social adversity and professional adversity. And I can't get through Rocky 1 without crying, but I have literally watched these movies over and over and over again. I think there's a lot of good lessons in that series of movies.
One more deeper question. Who do you reach out for advice in your personal life or your professional life?
So for me, on a personal level, I have a network of friends and a couple of people in my family that I can share things with, can express frustration and doubt, and see if they can help me see something clearer from the outside. So my father, for example, has had lots of adversity, lots of challenges, lots of things, including four wives in his life. So I don't ask him about marriage advice. I do ask him about other things in his life. He's been very helpful in giving me some perspective.
That's great, yeah. It's a very lonely journey as an entrepreneur, so I think
that's so. It's scary.
Very scary. You might keep touching my heart and say, am I breathing yet? Well, you've been so successful already. Why not just go to Bahamas and a beach and have fun?
So I've been married for 25 years and my wife will not let me retire. She will not let me stay home. This is literally my seventh job in my career. So I'm 52 years old in October. I had a job for 5 years at Pershing, which was the back office of the Wall Street. And literally I showed up the first day after graduating from UC Berkeley with an economics degree in the one suit I owned. I had two shirts and two ties. And this old guy, probably my age now, in a bow tie, sent me to the mailroom to stuff envelopes. So I made it there 5 years. Then I got married at 27. My wife decided to not work anymore outside the house and start having our kids. So then I worked at Bear Stearns for 14 years. And I worked my way up to be one of the youngest senior managing directors in the custody finance business of hedge funds and broker dealers. I then had a second midlife crisis at 39. Left Wall Street and became an entrepreneur, moved to the Midwest and failed in my first entrepreneurial business. Went back to some friends, Aaron and Steve, got some money from Sequoia, and ran a company called Merlin Securities. And Merlin was a technology fintech company that dealt with hedge funds. We did finance and trading and technology, and we sold that in July of 12 to Wells Fargo Bank. And I stayed at Wells Fargo for a couple months to help Wells absorb Merlin, and then did what I love, and that was really this peer-to-peer lending, this online lending. And so my partners and I, Aaron and Steve, went back to Sequoia and said, you gave us $20 million in 08 for Merlin, and we exited beautifully, and you made a lot of money. We have another idea. Lending Club's doing really well, and Prosper, not so well, but they have the right bones, the right people, some of the right data. We want to buy Prosper. And so we did, January of 13, they put up $10 million, we put up most of the rest, and assumed control of Prosper, and called Peter Rent and said, we need to talk.
Fantastic journey. I have a couple of more questions, and then I'll open up the floor, so get ready with your questions, and then we have a mic in the audience too. So we started the interview with the chat with what gets you up in the morning. What keeps you awake at night?
So for me, I fear this data breach, right? This moment where our industry or these platforms lose control of the data, the investor data and the borrower data. There's this breach and people don't want to give us information about themselves as a borrower or as investors, they don't want us to have their bank and credit information. And so I really think about the credit of this industry. And I also think about the people that work with us and for us, that these are people with families and with careers. And how do we bring more smart people into our industry from the banking world, from the technology world, from Wall Street? And then what do we do to help these people have these great careers? And we did that in the prime brokerage business, one of my first careers. And I think we're doing that in the fintech, in the internet finance, in this peer-to-peer online lending world. We're bringing people from all over the world, from all aspects, into it. And so I wonder is how do we attract even more really smart entrepreneurial people into everything that we're doing around the world?
Last personal question before we open the floor. You made 15 odd investments. What is the common theme? How do you pick them? Because there are investors around here who would love to sort of see what's the philosophy you follow.
So for me, investing is as much about your IQ, your intelligence, as it is about your emotional intelligence, your emotional quotient. I think Lou and I were talking about this the other day. It's what do you feel about somebody or something without any written words? What's their body language? What's happening around them? And so you can go to crunchbase.com and see a couple of my investments. When I met Mike Cagney from SoFi 22 years ago, I knew he was this really crazy genius, right? And so when he told me about his idea about SoFi in 2011, I invested. I invested in the equity, I invested in the students, I invested in the securitization, and then again in the equity. When I met Matt Burton in 2013 from Orchard, I knew that this guy was a winner. Even if his idea wasn't perfect, he would bring the right people and pivot at that moment. And so the same with Avid Exchange or other groups borrowing and lending money. It's about the people. It's about your feeling about them. It's about the total addressable market. How big is this opportunity? And can they actually get the unit economics right? So even if the opportunity is big, if the cost to bring on the product is higher than they can ever sell it for, you can't make it up with time and scale. So I'm looking for the right people, the right total addressable market, with the right unit economics, and some ability to exit and continue to raise capital. So for me, those are really the five things I think about, but it really starts and stops with the people. If you have a big opportunity and the wrong people, you have no choice, no chance. Give the right people and a medium to big opportunity, you can really make magic.
Sure. We're gonna open up the floor. Any questions, raise your hand, we can get a mic to you.
I guess as Mukesh has illustrated, I think you've had a fairly successful professional run over the last 25 years or so that you've really been working. What is at this point in time really your professional goal over the next 10 years or so? How do you see yourself shaping the next 10 years of your life?
So I would actually like to be a teacher. And so I've been doing that, traveling the world and giving presentations about fintech, about opportunity, about intention. My favorite group to teach with are seniors in college. Because for me, that moment, that pivot from school to the working world is very difficult. So I've traveled around the world and around the country. Every month I'm usually teaching somewhere, but I would like to take that to another level and really just help people at that moment of 18 pivot from the academic world to the real world, whether it's profit or nonprofit. That to me is one of my passions.
Hi Ron, it's Wilson. Thank you very much for coming. One question, you talked about intelligence quotient and emotional quotient. How about adversity quotient? Kind of in this industry where it's kind of new, there's lots of adverse laws against it. How do you deal with these kind of uphill battles and what kind of advice do you have for other people in this kind of situation?
Yeah, Yeah, so it's so funny. Peter and I have been talking about this topic for 3 years. I don't think our competition as online lenders, whether you're in real estate or student loans or mortgages or consumer franchises, whatever, it's not each other, it's not the banks, it's not really the credit cards. Our competition is this lack of EA and U, which is education, awareness, and understanding. And so unfortunately, all this stuff that's happening in our industry, the Lending Club debacle and some of these other issues, has created this enormous awareness about what we're doing and what we're trying to accomplish. And I tried to articulate that story on CNBC in Hong Kong early this morning about what a great opportunity it is, what good we are doing in helping borrowers get the right credit or the credit they deserve, and helping investors around the world, people and institutions, get the yield that everybody's looking for. And so for me, I think you have to look for the silver lining in adversity, whether it's the hole in the shoe or the PRMS at Lending Club, that it will work out over time. But I think you have to really watch for the opportunity in all this and try to stay on the high road as best you can through all of this and kind of stay away from the mudslinging. But I think there's always a silver lining. You just have to find it. There was something I actually retweeted yesterday. You fall down in life because there's something down there someone thinks you're supposed to find.
Boy, I'm not waiting to ask this question. So I've known you for about 20 years now, and I know you're obviously very successful and very humble and don't like to talk about your own traits and abilities, but I think it would be interesting for the audience to have you actually hear you describe about what's been the key to your success and what you've been able to do and focus, and maybe others can learn from it as well.
So how many people here are married? Can you see a show of hands? So I had a talk on the bus ride over here with someone who's getting married about this very topic. And so I think the person that you marry is a really big part of your success. Is this somebody that understands you, that knows where you want to go, that knows what your anxiety is, that knows what your faults are, and they can keep you within the rails and keep you to the point you need to get? For me, I'm married for 25 years to a lady named Karen, who was tough, but she understood who I was. I understood and understand who she is. And if I had married the wrong person, I would not have been able to keep it all together, whether it was raising our two kids or the success we had or the travel or all the adversity that comes in life. So I think that's one of the key things. And I think the other thing is self-awareness, right? We all have ego and thoughts about ourselves, and we all have this negative voice inside us that says some negative stuff sometimes. So this concept of self-awareness and really understanding who you are, kind of when you're full of you know what, and when what you know is right, you have to go for it. That combination of having the right partner and the right awareness of who you are and when you're kind of believing your own stuff, and really watching out for that old tape that plays inside all of us. That's that negative tape that pops in and plays over and over, because we're moving that tape and really listening to what your intention is versus some old stuff you might have heard. Or maybe you were labeled as the good boy or the good girl or the smart one or the funny one. It's removing those labels and being your own self-aware, meaningful person in your life, both at home and at work.
Last one. I'm getting greedy. If you had a tweet today from Ron, what would that be? So Ron put out our phones and tweet that right now.
So my tweet for today would be to leave it all on the court today. Whatever you've got today, spend it. Use it. Go to bed exhausted and come back tomorrow and fight another day. And I think that's something you see in sports, that people didn't play all 48 minutes of the game. They played 47 minutes and didn't leave it all on the court. And so for me, my tweet would be, leave it all on the court today.
For the first time, hearing Ron speak about himself in Hong Kong. Thank you very much, Ron. What a journey we've had. Thank you very much.